Hey guys, so welcome back to another Mavic 4 Pro tutorial. In today's video, I'm going to walk you through the best video settings possible for your Mavic 4 Pro. But we're not only going to talk about shutter speed, resolution and ISO, we're also going to talk about movement, because it really comes down to how well you are flying your drone, how smooth your movement is, and I'm going to help you out with that as well. So if you pay attention in this video and apply all these tips and tricks I'm going to give you, I guarantee you, you're 100% going to level up your drone game. All right, so let's start off by diving into the menu and working our way down from the top. First up is white balance. I highly recommend you to never set white balance to auto. The reason for this is because it can shift mid-shot and it can actually just straight up ruin your footage. A good and simple trick to set your white balance if you don't know how to do it is just fly your drone up into the sky and find the scene you want to shoot. Now let the camera do the auto adjusting once, then switch the auto off again. That locks it in a solid base and you can tweak it further in post if needed. Alright, so next up is resolution. Now the beautiful thing about the Mavic 4 Pro is that it can shoot all the way up to 6K resolution, and that is exactly what we want to take full advantage of. This gives us the most detail and post-production flexibility. However, if you're shooting with the 70mm and the 168mm lenses, you are limited to 4K resolution. These telephoto options don't support 6K, so just be aware of that trade-off. Alright, so next up is frame rate. Now the industry standard for cinematic footage is 24 or 25 frames per second, giving you that smooth, natural film look. But for drone footage, I actually recommend shooting at 30 frames per second. And the reason for this is because I have found that drone footage tends to be a little more stuttering and a little more choppy than regular handheld camera footage. And shooting in 30 frames per second helps reduce that stuttering and choppiness while still keeping that natural film look. Now you can also shoot at 60 frames per second, which will give you the option to slow down the footage in post if you want to. The trade-off here is that regular playback at 60 frames per second often looks too smooth, almost artificial-like, giving you a soap opera effect. Next, set your color profile to D-Log, not D-Log M. D-Log is the best option if you want the most out of your details in the bright skies and in the shadows. It gives you far more dynamic range and flexibility when color grading in post. However, keep in mind that D-Log M tends to be a little bit easier to work with. If you're using the higher end model of the Mavic 4 Pro, switch the video codec to All-I or All-Intra. It gives you better image quality and detail, which lets us color grading nerds really push the image further in post. But be aware that All-Intra file sizes are massive. 20 seconds of 6K at 60 frames per second equals almost 3 gigabytes, and 20 seconds of 6K at 25 frames per second equals almost 1.5 gigabytes. That is why I only recommend using All-Intra for your best, most cinematic shots where quality truly matters. If you're using the base model or don't have access to All-Intra, you'll be working with H.265, which still delivers amazing quality with much more efficient file sizes. Alright, so moving over to exposure and ISO. Set your ISO as low as possible to reduce noise. In D-Log, the lowest ISO is 400 and that's your default starting point. Only raise ISO if the image is too dark and you've already exhausted your other exposure options. Now for the shutter speed, we are going to stick to something called the 180 degree shutter rule for natural motion blur. That means your shutter speed should be double your frame rate. So if you're shooting at 30 frames per second, set this to 1 over 60. Now also try to avoid adjusting shutter speed for exposure unless you absolutely have to. It affects motion smoothness and can make your footage feel unnatural. Now for the aperture, this is gonna depend on how you expose, so start by keeping an eye on your EV meter. You want it to sit as close to zero as possible. That's your baseline for proper exposure. The aperture setting is the main thing we're going to adjust to expose correctly. And the key rule here is always protect your highlights. If the sky is too bright, try and slightly underexpose. We can lift the shadows later in post, but we can't bring back those highlights once they are blown out. If the image is still too bright and you've already stopped down all the way to f11, the best solution is to use ND filters. And this becomes basically essential when you're using the 70mm or the 168mm lenses. You can't stop them down, so ND filters are a must in bright conditions. Now, if you don't have ND filters, your only other option is to raise the shutter speed. But again, this is a trade-off. It will reduce motion blur and it might make your footage feel a little less cinematic, but if it saves the shot, it is absolutely worth it. Now let's talk about movement, because how your drone moves is a huge part of what makes footage feel cinematic and smooth. So tap the three dots in the top right. Go to the control tab and scroll down and tap gain and expo tuning. Also make sure cine mode is selected. Now we're gonna tweak the following settings. First up is max angular velocity. This adjusts how fast the drone rotates left or right. I recommend to set this around 20 degrees a second for more controlled and natural looking cinematic movements. Next, we have yaw smoothness. These settings help soften your rotations, easing into and out of pans smoothly. I recommend keeping this somewhere around 20. Now the brake sensitivity controls how quickly the drone comes to a stop after you release the stick. Set this to 100 for a more graceful stop instead of a jarring brake. The Expo settings change how sensitive the sticks are. Lower values makes your movement smoother and more gradual. Higher values makes the drone react too suddenly, which looks jerky, so I always keep my Expo values low for maximum control. Alright, so next up we have max control speed for the gimbal tilt. Now this limits how fast your gimbal tilts up and down. I keep this at about 10 degrees a second to avoid fast robotic tilts. Next to that we have tilt smoothness. This determines how gently the gimbal stops tilting after you let go of the wheel. I like to max this out to get that smooth glide in and glide out effect. You don't want your camera to slam to a stop mid-shot. Alright, so next up we have the new Infinity gimbal. The same apply here, so a lower number makes it so that the Infinity gimbal stops rotating instantly when you let go of the wheel. So set roll smoothness to 20, and the same with max roll speed. Set this to 5 degrees a second for a more balanced, natural speed. We're also going to change the controls for the Infinity gimbal itself. It's too complicated as it is, so go on and head over to controls, then scroll down to button customization, then find right dial zoom in out. Tap it, then select control, and select gimbal roll. Now the right wheel controls roll instead of zoom. I never use the zoom wheel anyway, so this just makes more sense. Now keep in mind that these are the settings that I use and I prefer, so I highly recommend that you actually go outside and just play with these settings yourself, but using my settings can be a good starting point. Now if you found this video helpful and if you don't want to miss out on any of my upcoming videos, don't forget to smash that like and subscribe button before you leave. That would also be highly appreciated. Take care, fly safe, and I'll see you guys in my next video. Bye.